بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله العظيم من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. يهدي الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد، يحيي ويميت وهو حي لا يموت، بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله، أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح للأمة وكشف الغمة وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك، فعليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم، وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. أمين رب العالمين. وأوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل، وقد أمرنا بالحق وقال تعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. ثم أما بعد، we begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for declaring His perfection and declaring that none has the right to be worshipped or unconditionally obeyed except for Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His final messenger, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Him as a mercy to the world and a guide to mankind. And the only example to be followed after Him that would enter a person into paradise. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those that follow Him, His companions, His family, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to gather us with them in the highest level of Jannatul Firdaus. Allahumma ameen. Dear brothers and sisters, I know it's Valentine's Day, and I know a lot of people are going to be giving khutbas about Valentine's Day, and I will not be talking about Valentine's Day at all, because I feel like if you are celebrating Valentine's Day, that probably means you're committing zina, so there's a bigger issue to be discussed than whether or not it's halal to celebrate Valentine's Day. So I think that we need to move beyond these things as believers and talk about things that are as relevant to us as possible. So I'll give you the quick answer to that, because I saw all of these threads online, khutbah about Valentine's Day, about love, about Valentine's Day. Celebrating Valentine's Day is not halal. So we can move on now to our actual topic. And what we're going to do is we're going to continue what we spoke about 2 weeks ago, which was the topic of Al-Amana. I started off this topic based upon actually Sheikh Yasir doing this series on the signs of the last day. And obviously the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned that from the greatest signs of the minor signs is when Amana is lost, when a sense of trust is lost. And subhanAllah, as we take that topic into our everyday lives and we see how we can apply it into our family relationships, into our work ethics, then we find that many of us have lost this quality, unfortunately. And it's a very rare and special quality that requires a certain level of the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then we had a talk at night. And subhanAllah, one of the brothers asked a question. He said, well, what do you say to the one who says that if I dealt honestly in my business, then I would never make money? What do you say to that person? And my answer was that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a wazzaq. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gives sustenance anyway. And that even if you betray those ethics, and even if you betray that trust that's been given to you by the one that you're dealing with, you will not attain of this world not even a penny more than what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written for you. And so I wanted to talk about this ayah today, continuing on that topic. وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. Taqwa is the foundation of amana. Taqwa is the foundation of trust with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and trust with the people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is aware and conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will always make a way out for him. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tied the entire concept of risk to taqwa. وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. And Allah will grant him sustenance from places that he never even thought about or imagined or dreamed of. And so we take from this ayah first and foremost
that taqwa is a means of bringing rizq into your life. Taqwa is a means of attaining sustenance in your life, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tied not only forgiveness and making a way out because of taqwa, as a result of taqwa, but rather good things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would provide for you. And the very first thing to address with this ayah, يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make a way out for them. You know, I've had people that have, alhamdulillah, left haram businesses, for example. And they say, you know, alcohol, I own a gas station, and alcohol accounts for 30% or 40% of my sales and my income. Does that mean that if I stop selling alcohol, that my salary, I can expect my salary to increase the next year? No, you're going to have to struggle. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. Allah said He'll make a way out for you. Allah did not say that that way out is going to be easy. You still have to find the way out. And you know, if you create a fire in your house, if you start a fire in your house and the fire has gotten large enough, then you're going to have to look for more and more limited ways of getting yourself out of that fire, out of that burning house. You can count on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to provide for you that window, but if you've been kindling that fire for 15, 20 years, then know that you're probably going to have to crawl out of the smallest window of your house, but Allah will make sure that window is there. So we dig ourselves in holes, and we need to know, we need to be assured that Allah will make a way out for us, but we have to struggle for that way out. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not mention the level of difficulty of reaching that way out. So that's the first thing. And the second thing is, يَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. Allah will grant you sustenance in ways that you could not imagine before. Which means that, let's say that I dealt in a halal way, or I did something right, and you know, perhaps I suffered a loss of income in that regard. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would provide for me from a source that I never thought of in the first place. So I wanted to cover a few of the examples that we find from the biographies of the great companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the pious predecessors. And first and foremost, let's just start with this incident to try to understand this concept. And this is an incident that's narrated by Abdullah ibn Zubayr ibn Asim. Okay? So it's not Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu ta'ala anhu ibn Zubayr al-Awwam, but rather, this is afterwards, this is Abdullah ibn Zubayr ibn Aslam, I'm sorry, ibn Aslam. And he narrates this on the authority of his father, from his father, Aslam. And Aslam, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, was the one that used to go out with Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu most frequently on his night patrols. So we talk about amana. There is no one that felt a greater sense of amana than Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And there is no greater amana and trust than the amana of leadership and authority, as was illustrated in the hadith that we discussed 2 weeks ago. And we mentioned how Umar radiallahu anhu cared for every being under his authority, under his control, and he instituted something that was admired not just by Muslim scholars and historians, but that's admired by any man of sense without bias that would study the seerah of this man. Because no other leader in history implemented nightly patrols to check up on his people and those that were living under his authority. And so Aslam radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says that I was with my father Umar al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu during one of his journeys. And every night Umar would take someone else, but I was the most frequent of those. Sometimes we find Umar radiallahu anhu, as a means of tarbiyah, would take Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, for example, or Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Not just his own kids, but rather some of the scholars of the companions as a means of tarbiyah for them and for himself. And they would take those bags of rice and flour and wheat, and they would patrol the streets. So he said, I was the most frequent of those that used to go with Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu on his night patrols. And he said, as we were checking on the condition of a people, we overheard a mother having a conversation with her daughter. And in essence, the mother is telling the daughter to take the milk and to dilute it with water. To put water inside the milk so that we could increase the leaven, so that we could increase its quantity. And as the mother is telling her daughter to do that, the daughter is saying back to the mother, and Umar radiallahu anhu is overhearing this entire conversation. She says, oh my mother, don't you know that Amir al-Mu'mineen, don't you know that the commander of the believers has prohibited us from doing that? Why did Umar radiallahu anhu prohibit that? Because of the cheating that would take place in the marketplace, right? watering your perfumes, your colognes, your milk, whatever it may be, you know, portraying a greater quantity than what it actually is, Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu put a ban on those things. And Umar radiallahu anhu was very specific with his bans. And so the mother responded back to the daughter and said, where is Umar right now? Where is Umar right now? Meaning Umar can't hear us or see us right now. And the daughter responds back to the mother with very beautiful words. She says to the mother, Ya Ummi, O my mother, ما كنت لأطيعه في العلن وأخالفه في السر. I'm not going to obey him in public and then disobey him in private. And she said the very beautiful, famous words. She said, وَإِن كَانَ عُمَرُ لَا يَرَانَا. And if Umar does not see us right now, فَإِلَاهُ عُمَرْ يَرَانَا. The Lord of Umar sees us right now. SubhanAllah. Look at how this girl is talking to her mother with that level of taqwa. You couldn't rehearse this any better, right? You would think it's as if she knew Umar radiallahu anhu was there. You couldn't rehearse this any better. And you couldn't script this any better. And that's why the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so perfect that at that moment when Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu walks by all of the houses of Medina, at that particular moment Umar was next to that house when that mother and that daughter were having that conversation about that policy. This is the perfect planning of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says to Aslam, he says, put a mark on their door. Now if there was any other leader in the world, put a mark on her door would mean that tomorrow we're coming and we're going to raid this house and we're going to arrest the mother. How dare you say that Umar is not watching me right now? You know, the obsessed, the power-hungry, intoxicated with power dictators that we have today would say, you know what, we have to go and get her. We're not worrying about rewarding the daughter, we're worrying about punishing the mother for disobeying our orders. So Umar radiallahu anhu didn't tell Aslam why. He just said, oh Aslam, put a mark on this door. Remember this house. Tomorrow something is going to go down. What was going to go down? Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, go tomorrow and find out about them. Find out about who these people are. So Aslam goes, and Aslam radiallahu ta'ala anhu asks about this mother and this daughter, and Aslam comes to find out that the mother is a widow, and so it's only her and her daughter, and they have, you know, very little means, not too much provisions, which makes the answer of the daughter even more impressive, right? You know, that even then, even in those conditions, in those harsh conditions, she didn't feel entitled to cheat. You know, sometimes we cheat without even needing to cheat, to get an extra dollar. They actually needed it. And she's still saying to her mother, we're not going to do this because the Lord of Umar sees us right now. So Aslam comes back and he tells Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu that, you know, this is the situation of this mother and this daughter. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu then calls a meeting with his sons. And he said, who amongst you is married? So all of his sons answer, except for Asim ibn Umar al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He says, you know, I'm looking for a wife. And so Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the next day, himself, Amir al-Mu'mineen, goes to this home with his son Asim to propose to her in marriage. Allahu Akbar. To propose to her in marriage. Think about what that means. Not only did he not punish the mother, not only did he, you know, it would have been enough if he would have given her some words of encouragement like, I heard you, or made dua for her. But Umar radiallahu anhu was so impressed by her. She didn't need to be of the royal family. She didn't need to have a royal lineage. Because of her taqwa. Because of her taqwa, which teaches us a lesson in marriage. Umar wanted his son to be married to her. And of course, this is what the Prophet said about Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. That there were people that came before that were muhaddathun. Not muhaddithun. That were muhaddathun. Muhaddath means to speak. Muhaddath means to be spoken to. So muhaddith is someone who collects ahadith. Muhaddith means spoken to by the malaika, spoken to by the angels, although they are not prophets. In my ummah, that's Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He always has rushd. He always has guidance to the right decisions. He knows what to do, and he has a source of inspiration that the average human being does not have. So Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu goes and he marries his son Asim to this girl. And Asim and this young woman have a daughter by the name of Layla. And Layla gives birth to Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, rahimahullah ta'ala, wa radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, the fifth of Khulafa al-Rashideen, the one who Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah, said, he is to the rest of the khulafa, like Rajab is to the rest of the Muharram months, like Rajab is to the rest of the sacred months. Meaning, although Rajab is separated from the other three months, it is still one of them. So he is to the other four khulafa, what Rajab is to the other months of that are Muharram. Think about what that means. SubhanAllah, from this taqwa, from this one incident, what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give to that girl? Did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala simply, you know, did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only make the milk grow? Did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala boost their income? Did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send a generous man the next day to give them money? Or did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give her something that was far better than that in regards to her dunya or her akhirah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave her the son of the ruler, the son of Amir al-Mu'mineen, as a husband that would provide for them in this dunya. And as for her akhirah, she had from her offspring, from her sadaqa jariya, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz rahimahullah ta'ala. وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. Allah made a way out for her. وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسَبُ. And Allah provided things. Would she have ever dreamed, in her wildest imaginations, would she have ever thought that because of what I'm saying right now, maybe Umar will find out and send me his son to marry me, and perhaps we'll have a grandson that will be the fifth of Khulafa al-Rashideen? She was the daughter-in-law of the second of Khulafa al-Rashideen and the grandmother of the fifth of them. How amazing is that? From one incident of taqwa, from one incident of aman, we also find that the Prophet ﷺ, Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, narrates his first meeting with the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, as lofty of a scholar as he is in this deen, Ibn Mas'ud before Islam was a man of no lineage, was a man of no status in society. His parents sold him to Uqba bin Abi Mu'id to be his slave, to be his shepherd, to be his ruwayy al-ghanam, to be the one that would be a shepherd to a sheep. And at the same time, he didn't have much physical stature. He really wasn't worth much before Islam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passes one day with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. He says that I was in my teens, you know, between the age of 13 and 18 year old. He was a very young man. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passes with Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu by him on a journey. And they don't know each other. And Rasulullah ﷺ sees this shepherd, and he says to him, هَلْ لَكَ مِنْ شَاتٍ فِيهَا لَبَنْ. Do you have any one of these goats that can provide milk? And Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu doesn't know who he is. قَالَ نَعَمْ. He said, I'm not going to lie to you. He said, yes, وَلَكِنِّي غُلَامٍ مُؤْتَمَرٍ. He said, yes, but I am a young man that's been entrusted with this flock. I can't give you any of that milk. So the Prophet ﷺ تَبَسَّمَ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ عَجَبَتْهُ صلى الله عليه وسلم. He was impressed by what I said to him. So he says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiled. فَقَالَ ائْتِنَا بِشَاتٍ لَا لَبِنَا فِيهَا. He said, you know what, give me a goat that doesn't have any milk. So I said, well, okay, you know, that's not going to betray the trust that I have with my owner. We're not wasting anything. He said, I'll bring him a goat that has no milk. So he said, I brought one without milk. And he said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put his hands on the udders of that milk. وَقَالَ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ. And the Prophet ﷺ said, Bismillah, in the name of Allah. So he said, فَإِذَا بِهَا يَمْتَلِئُ لَبَنًا. He said, all of a sudden it started to produce milk, you know, at high quantities. He said, ثُمَّ شَرِبَ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ ثُمَّ سَقَى أَبِي بَكْرٍ وَسَقَانِي مِنْهَا. He said, then the Prophet ﷺ drank, and he gave to Abu Bakr to drink, and he even gave me a glass to drink as well. He said, as I'm watching this, he says, ثُمَّ عَادَتْ كَمَا كَانَتْ. He said, as soon as I finished drinking my milk, it no longer was producing anymore. So he says, فَقُلْتُ يَا عَمْ. He said, I said, oh uncle, عَلِّمْنِي مِنْ هَذَا الْقَوْلِ الَّذِي قُلْتُ. Teach me these words that you just said. He thought it was, he doesn't know that this is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, maybe this is some, you know, what they were used to in that society was magic and spells and things of that sort. Maybe these words were special. And the Prophet, he says, and this was the beautiful tarbiyah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, فَمَسَحَ عَلَى صَدْرِي. He said, the Prophet ﷺ wiped on my chest. Meaning what? As a means of encouragement. وَقَالْ إِنَّكَ غُلَامٌ مُعَلَّمٌ. You are a young man of knowledge. SubhanAllah, he was praising him عليه الصلاة والسلام. Then he says, فَلَمَّا ذَهَبَ. بدأت أسأل عنهما. He said, whenever the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم left, he said, I started asking all these people, who is this man? What is he about? He said, as soon as I knew who he was, he said, I went to Dar al-Arqam, where I saw the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم meeting with Abu Bakr رضي الله تعالى عنه, and the first Sahaba that entered. And he said, I said, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. I bear witness that there is no God but Allah and that you are the Messenger of Allah. This entire account is actually narrated in Musnad Imam Ahmad by the son of Ibn Mas'ud رضي الله تعالى عنه. How beautiful is that? And Ibn Mas'ud رضي الله تعالى عنه was the sixth or seventh person to enter into Islam. Now had Ibn Mas'ud رضي الله تعالى عنه thought to himself, how much can you pay? You know what? I know how bad you really want to drink right now. How much can you pay me right now? What can you do for me right now? Then this entire conversation would not have taken place. But instead, the Prophet ﷺ was able to see this beautiful young man, that beautiful trait of an amana, which made the Prophet ﷺ happy. And on top of that, he got the greatest form of rizq that has ever existed. And what is that rizq? An Islam, an iman. We don't consider that risk. We don't consider that sustenance. Allah bestowed upon him as a result of that al-Islam, faith. And subhanAllah, all of this was as a result of his good quality of al-amana, of his trustworthiness. And there's something to be said that's very special about that. And you know, subhanAllah, I was going to share an incident, even last week actually, I had this in my notes to share this incident. And I saw this week in particular, a video on YouTube go viral. And the video on YouTube that went viral are two men in Saudi Arabia that are pulling up to a shepherd. And you're talking about a Bedouin in the middle of the desert. You can barely make out what he's saying. And they're testing him and they're saying to him, give us one of your sheep. And the man is responding, you know, I'm not going to do that. He said, it's not mine for me to give. And they're saying, just tell the owner that it's lost. He said, what do you mean it's lost? He said, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's no such thing as it's lost. He said, when I go to the grave, am I going to be able to say that it's lost? He said, the owner can't see you right now. And this Bedouin man, even now in the 21st century, points up to the sky and said, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees me. Allah sees me. And he's telling him it's absolutely impossible. Then they say to him, na'tik mitan riyal, we'll give you 200 riyals. And he said, even if you gave me 200,000 riyals. That's in the 21st century. See what Iman does to people? See what Islam does to people? Even if you gave me 200,000 riyals, wallahi, I will not give it to you. I won't give you a single one of these sheep. And then a sheikh quotes the incident, which I was going to share, which is from an Imam al-Qurtubi, rahimahullah, very beautiful incident. From Abdullah ibn Umar, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that Ibn Umar, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, one time passed by a shepherd, and he wanted to test the shepherd of that sheep. So Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu said, give me one of your sheep. He said, أَنَا مَمْلُوك وَمُؤْتَمَنُ. He said, I am owned, and at the same time, I'm a slave, and at the same time, I've been trusted with this flock. Ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, say to the owner, قُلْ لِلْمَالِكِ أَكَلَهَا الذِّئْبُ. Say to the owner that one of the wolves ate the sheep. The same thing that the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salam said. Let's see if this lie works. Just tell your owner, it's more believable with a sheep. With sheep than it is with a human being. Tell the owner that, you know what, a wolf ate it. And the man responded to Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu and said, فَمَاذَا أَقُولُ لِلَّهِ فَمَاذَا أَقُولُ لِلَّهِ. What will I say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What will I say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? As a result of that, Ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu purchased his freedom and he said to him the very beautiful words. He said, كَلِمَةٌ أَعْتَقَتْكَ فِي الدُّنْيَا. That these were words, أَعْتَقَتْكَ فِي الدُّنْيَا, it freed you. This one word that you said earned you your freedom in this dunya. He said, وَأَسْأَلُ اللَّهَ أَنْ تَعْتِقَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. He said, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَنْ تَعْتِقَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, that it will free you on the day of judgment. The same word that you said that freed you in this world, I ask Allah that it will free you on the day of judgment. Dear brothers and sisters, the conclusion of this, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. Whoever fears Allah, Allah will make a way out for him and will give him risk from places that he never imagined before. One of the biggest mistakes that we make as human beings is we have restricted the meaning of risk to money. We've restricted it to finances. And so we have, because of us restricting it to that, we simply think that, you know what, that means that if I'm not making the same amount of money or more than what I made last year, that means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is restricting his sustenance from me. But what about the risk of the peace of mind of knowing that you have halal money? What about the risk of the peace of mind that knowing that you haven't betrayed anyone, having a good relationship with your family members, being someone who's trustworthy, not having to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment because you didn't fear him in this world? What about all of that? What about the barakah, the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts in your life? And what about the things that perhaps, because it's min haythu la yahtasib, it's from places that you never imagined, the blessings that you never even associated with your taqwa, what about those blessings that come? Rizq is much broader. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-Razzaq, and he is the one who gives sustenance. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us of this dunya that which is good for us, and to give us of the akhirah that which is good for us, and to protect us from the punishment of hellfire. Allahumma ameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullahi wa lakum wa lisa'iril muslimin fastaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafurur rahim.
12 عينا قد علم كل أناس مشربهم كلوا واشربوا من رزق الله ولا تعثوا.
الحمد لله رب العالمين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين ولا عاقبة للمتقين. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على عبدك ورسولك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Dear brothers and sisters, you know, as I was preparing for this class that's coming up on Sunday at ICI, which is about some of the important black sahaba, which is, by the way, based on a work by Imam Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah, and how racism was fought in the time of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I thought of something to myself which is also related to this topic. And that is particularly about Bilal ibn Rabah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Had Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu not taken that stand and said ahadun ahad, one God, and not stood for the truth, you know, he wouldn't have been beaten the way that he was beaten. He probably wouldn't have been dragged into the desert and dehydrated and had a stone placed on him. But you know what? He would have remained his entire life as a slave and nothing more than that. But because of his courage and because of his taqwa and his fear of al-ahad, of the one true God, and because of that stance that he took, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after just a few days of torture, made him Sayyidul Mu'adhdhinin, the master of those who give adhan, and one of the masters of this deen, and one of the people who even the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard his footsteps in paradise, and the man that would stand on top of the Kaaba and declare Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. When we stand for that which was right, and when we are ethical human beings, and when we fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all of our dealings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make for us and make of us that which we would have never expected before. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us when we lose that tawakkud, when we lose that sense of trust in Him. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those that rely upon Him in all of our dealings. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those that fear Him when we deal with Him and when we deal with the people. Allahumma khfir lil mu'minina wal mu'minat wal muslimina wal muslimat al ahya'i minhum wal amwat innaka sami'un qareebun mujibud da'wat. Allahumma khfir lana warhamna wa'fu 'anna wa la tu'adhibna. Rabbana zalamna anfusana wa in lam taghfir lana wa tarhamna lanakunanna min al khasirin. Allahumma innaka 'afuwun tuhibbul 'afwa fa'fu 'anna. Allahumma khfir li walidina رب ارحمهما كما ربونا صغارا. ربنا هب لنا من ازواجنا وذرياتنا قرة اعين واجعلنا للمتقين اماما. اللهم انصر المستضعفين في مشارق الارض ومغاربها. اللهم اهلك الظالمين بالظالمين واخرجنا من بينهم سالمين. عباد الله، ان الله يأمر بالعدل والاحسان وايتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزد لكم ولذكر الله اكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون.
وأقم الصلاة. مفسدين. وإذ قلتم يا موسى لن نصبر على طعام واحد فادع لنا